2017 with her poem "This Is Not a Humanizing Poem," which subsequently went viral, securing her performances on BBC Radio 4, Islam Channel, music festivals, and many other places. She runs a popular blog, thebrownhijabi.com, where she discusses race, gender, Islamophobia, intersectionality, and decoloniality. And she's talked about these topics at universities, museums, and in a TEDx talk. As a history and post-colonial studies graduate from Cambridge and SOAS respectively, her work often grapples with her topics of research, particularly regarding the experiences of South Asian diasporas and Muslims in Britain and their relationship to and with the security state. Salawat.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. So firstly, thank you very much for having me here today. It's always, I think, really nice to be in a Muslim community, in a mosque space, to talk. And I've had a few experiences of that, and I think it's very nice to have the premise being Islam, that we've had a reading from the Quran. I really enjoy that. So to give you a bit of context, the talk today is gonna be, the name I gave was Beyond the Moderate Extreme Binary. I'm gonna talk about these labels, moderate, extreme, and I'm gonna talk about them in a way that will try to uncover violence, what violence is, why it happens, and how we understand it. So to give you a bit of background about me, already a lot has been said, but I just to kind of explain why I'm talking about this in particular, I did my thesis last year, my research, kind of looking at the counterterrorism policy in the UK and looking at how it kind of imagines Muslims in Britain. So I also do poetry, performance poetry. So I'm gonna kind of thread performance poetry through this. Hopefully that will keep you engaged. But if you feel like you want to jeer, you can also do that. So to start with, I'm gonna start with a poem that I did. I wrote this last June. And this poem, I'm sure a lot of you will remember. I was living in London last year. I don't live in London anymore, but I'm sure you will remember that in May, there was the Manchester Arena attack. Then at the start of June, there was the London Bridge attack. Then there was the general election. Then there was Grenfell. And I, in the midst of all this, had to write a poem for a poetry slam that I was going to be in. And on the day after the London Bridge attack, was the day that I had to write this poem. And that night, I was living near, near Regent's Park Mosque. And I was, going there in the evenings. And this one evening I came out and I had a text from my mum and it said, don't know if you've seen the news, but be careful on your way home today. And I had that feeling that I'm sure a lot of us are familiar with. You want to feel sad, but you also feel scared, and you also feel angry, and you realize that you're being associated with something that must have happened, even though you don't know what that thing is that's happened. And so I tried to write about that and how I felt about that. So I'll perform the poem, and then what I'm going to do is kind of split the poem into three themes and expand on those. So if you don't mind, I'm gonna stand up because I can't perform sitting down. I find that strange. So hopefully you can still hear me. Can you hear me if I stand? Yeah? Okay. So.
You can lift the mic up, maybe.
Does that help in any way? Is that okay? Yeah. Should I lift this? It's, no, sorry. Okay, sorry. Some poems force you to write them, the way sirens force their way through window panes in the night, and you can't shut out the news, even when you try. Write a humanizing poem, my pen and paper goad me. Show them how wrong their preconceptions are. Be relatable. Write something upbeat for a change. Crack a smile. Tell them how you also cry at the end of Toy Story 3, and you're just as capable of bantering about the weather in the post office queue. Like everyone, you have no idea how to cook the perfect amount of pasta. Still, feed them stories of stoic humor. Make a reference to childhood. Tell an anecdote about being frugal. Mention the X factor. Be domestic, successful, ad les. Tell them you know brown boys who cry. About the sides of Assads, Amirs, and Hassans they don't know. The complex inner worlds of Samayas and Aishas. Tell them comedies as well as tragedies. How full of life we are. How full of love. But no, I put my pen down. I will not let that poem force me to write it because it is not the poem I want to write. It's the poem I have been reduced to. Reduced to proving my life is human because it is relatable. valuable because it is recognizable. But good GCSEs, family and childhood memories are not the only things that count as a life. Living is. So this will not be a Muslims are like us poem. I refuse to be respectable. Instead, love us when we're lazy. Love us when we're poor. Love us in our back-to-backs, council estates, depressed, unwashed, and weeping. Love us high as kites, unemployed, joyriding, time-wasting, failing at school. Love us filthy, without the right colour passports, without the right-sounding English. Love us silent, unapologising, shopping in Poundland, skiving off school, homeless, unsure, sometimes violent. Love us when we aren't athletes, when we don't bake cakes, when we don't offer our homes or free taxi rides after the event, when we're wretched, suicidal, naked, and contributing nothing. Love us then. Because if you need me to prove my humanity, I'm not the one that's not human. My mother texts me too after BBC News alerts. Are you safe? Let me know you're home okay. And she means safe from the incident, yes, but also from the after effects. So sometimes I wonder, which days of the week might I count as liberal and which moments of forehead to the ground am I conservative? I wonder, when you buy bombs, is there a clear difference between the deadly ones that kill and the heroic ones which scatter democracy? I wonder, isn't it really guilty until proven innocent? How can we kill in the name of saving lives? How can we illegally detain in the name of maintaining the law? I can't write it. I put my pen away. I can't, I won't write it. Is this radical? Am I radical? Because there is nowhere else left to exist now. So I'm going to break that down into three kind of themes. The first theme is what I'm talking about in the first half of the poem. So there is this poem that I want to write. And this poem, I think, is an urge that a lot of us have had. And we want to say, I'm just like you. I'm normal. We're not all bad. I cry too. I am also very boring. I also spend a lot of time wasting my time. And we just want to prove that we are human, like other people. And I understand, I think the urge to do that comes from the fact that we see lots of negative images about Muslims, right? In the media, political rhetoric is the idea that Muslims are criminal, are mainly violent, are mainly terrorists. And so we have this desire, which is understandable, to say, well, we're not all like that. You know, most of us are normal, most of us are good. But my issue, and if you follow the poem, you will have seen, is that actually, when you start kind of saying, well, there are good Muslims, you don't manage to actually undermine the idea that there are bad Muslims. Instead, you fall into creating this binary idea that there are good and bad Muslims. And when you do that, you actually don't fundamentally question the premise that we should have to prove our humanity at all. So for example, when a white man goes into a school in America, shoots and kills people, nobody asks, where are the good white people to condemn this? You know, where this is a bad one, where are the good ones? And the reason is because we don't see humanity as conditional for that person. Whereas when it comes to a lot of Muslims, we say, your humanity is conditional on you proving your value. So, you know, will you bake for us? Will you be a good athlete for us? Will you, you know, contribute to this country? And you'll have seen the same thing recently with the Windrush scandal, right? There's this, I don't know if a lot of you have been following it, but the David Lammy, the MP, has been talking a lot against the deportation of a lot of the generation, the Windrush generation. And a lot of what he says is great, but my issue with what he says is that he falls into this as well. He says, there are the good migrants who contributed to the NHS, they came to this country, they've been loyal, patriotic, they've worked hard, and that's all well and good. But the implication when you make the argument is that there are some bad migrants. There are some who do deserve to be deported. There are some who do deserve dehumanization. And so the same is true for the good Muslim, bad Muslim thing. When we kind of try to assert so much that we are human, that we deserve being seen as like everybody else, we fall into the trap of saying, but there are some of us who don't. There are some of us who deserve dehumanization, who deserve violation of their human rights. Yeah? So that's my kind of first issue. And I think it also talks to the bigger issue, which is something that I think is very important for us all to understand in the UK right now. So we often hear the idea that Muslim extremists and Muslim terrorists are the biggest threat to our democracy, to our human rights, to our liberal universal values. But actually, what we need to question is whether these universal human rights are universal, when in fact you have a lot of humans in the UK who face violation of these rights. So they are detained without charge. This is happening right now to Muslims in this country, detained without charge. They are deported without being able to see the evidence for which that deportation is based. There is secret evidence, there are secret courts. There's all these kind of violations, right? And they're only possible because we don't actually extend the rights to everybody, because human rights can only apply if you're seen first as human, right? So that's to tie back to my original point, which is when we fall into the trap of saying, hey, we're not all bad, what we're actually saying is some of us are bad though, and therefore it is okay to still violate the rights of some of us. And so I'm gonna extend on this a little bit later, but that's the kind of first premise I want to put out there, that maybe the best way to confront those who dehumanize Muslims isn't to try to prove our humanity, but to ask why it is and for whose benefit that dehumanization takes place. What systems and what violence are allowed to happen when we do that? So the next part of the poem is where I say, so love us when we're lazy, love us when we're poor, in our back-to-back. So I'm from Leeds, and Leeds and Bradford, there's tons of back-to-back terraced housing. That's what the reference is to. And then council estates, all of this. So obviously I'm highlighting the social and economic disadvantages of Muslims in Britain. And I don't think it's a surprise to anyone in here. We kind of know that in general, the statistics show that Muslims in this country live in kind of the poorest council areas, the areas with the worst housing. I think Muslims in general are 3 times more likely to be unemployed. There's all sorts of statistics that can kind of prove social and economic disadvantage. So why am I talking about this? Well, because again, in one sense, I'm trying to say our humanity isn't based on the value of what we contribute to society. So whilst I personally don't necessarily think that everyone should be lazy, I say love us when we're lazy because we don't have to prove anything, we don't have to do or contribute anything to deserve human rights. That's ultimately what I'm saying. That I shouldn't have to live in danger just because I'm not, you know, economically contributing to society or because I'm perceived to be a kind of, you know, waste of space. The reason I phrase it like love us when, love us, I'm talking to somebody else, right? And I'm saying, you must love us. The reason I'm saying that is that to me, when you see, so here's a good example. In London, there's quite a lot of homelessness, right? When I see a homeless person, I don't think, right, what is it that you have done wrong that has led you to being homeless? I say, what is it that we as a society are doing wrong that means you are homeless? And I think that kind of sentiment is true in general. So what I'm trying to say here is that I think context is always important. And I say love us when X, Y, Z, because what I'm trying to say is perhaps the onus isn't on the victims of social and economic disadvantage to humanize themselves. Perhaps the onus is on wider society to alleviate those issues. Does that make sense? So another just small thing to throw in there is also that you might have seen last year, I think November time, there was a report about prisons in the UK, and it found that 15% of the prison population in the UK are Muslim. And in general, in the population, 4.4% of Britain is Muslim. So obviously that's a big discrepancy. It's almost like 3 times or more in prison. And again, I think to me, this is proof again of the where we need to talk about context, where we can't just say, oh, well, Muslims must be bad, right? 15% of them in prison, they must be terrible. I think, again, context has to come into the conversation, and it doesn't. So often it doesn't. There's a very famous prison abolitionist and Black Panther from the US, Angela Davis, and she has a really great quote, which I might be paraphrasing, but she said, prisons don't do away with social problems, they do away with people. And I think that's really relevant to this because what you're looking at when you look at prisons is the fact that people, 15% of Muslims, let's say, are locked up. And yet, the problems of those people aren't dealt with. So these socioeconomic problems that I've highlighted, but also perhaps the fact that Muslims are disproportionately racially profiled, stopped and searched, treated with suspicion, the kind of factors that might also lead to a heightened situation in which Muslims are ending up in prison. So that's just an example that I wanted to throw out there. But the main point of that bit is that context I really want us to think about. And now to join these two things together, right? The idea that we don't necessarily want to ask for our humanization, and the fact that we should always make people talk about context, leads me to the third part of the poem. So the third part is where I say, is there a difference between the deadly bombs that kill and the heroic ones which scatter democracy? And then I talk about, you know, the kind of ironies with the fact that it becomes legally okay to illegally detain, that we have these kind of contradictions and hypocrisies. What I'm talking about here is that we have contradictions in the way that we talk about violence. So I think the bomb example is the best one. There is a type of violence that's seen as good, as heroic, as okay, and that is the violence that is done by the government and the state. So when the government, for example, goes abroad and bombs a country, that's often seen as a way to civilize, a way to democratize. And it's not, maybe it's not said in such explicit ways that I'm saying it, but the overall kind of rhetoric and the way it's talked about is that it is okay, ultimately. It's not ultimately that bad. On the other hand, when you have people who are individuals who commit acts of violence, that violence is seen as completely reprehensible, not okay at all. And I'm not kind of endorsing either or, but what I'm saying is, isn't it interesting that we have this contradiction and hypocrisy in the way we talk about violence? Well, to bring it back to the other two themes that I've talked about, I don't think it's just accidental. I actually think it's quite deliberate, and I think there's a reason that we have this hypocrisy. It means that one type of violence is legitimate, and the other type is not. The other type becomes incomprehensible. We just can't explain why individuals are violent. And so the current understanding of why individuals are violent in this country comes down to kind of this idea. So Muslims are radicalized, yeah? And the idea of radicalization is essentially it's this process that takes a normal Muslim into a violent Muslim. Yeah, that's broadly the process, right? And so you have counter-radicalization and counter-terrorism policies which are to counter this. But if you look at that equation quite closely, the premise, the very first premise, so to take a normal Muslim into a violent one, is that the person is Muslim to start with, right? So the very premise is that you have to be Muslim. And the reason I'm trying to highlight that is to say that ultimately then the cause of violence is that you're Muslim in the first place. The reason for violence is the identity. Do you see how this might be flawed? That we're suddenly essentializing violence into a group of people. And when you do that, you're able to not hold accountable anything else for violence. You just say, well, it's natural that some of them will be violent because you kind of create this assumption that that's how it works. And you get this really scary consequence then where because any Muslim could become violent, all Muslims really require surveillance, right? They all are kind of deserving of suspicion because any of them could be violent. So then you have things like the PREVENT policy, which is a duty on all public bodies to look out for signs of radicalization. And these signs, so that's universities, schools, the NHS, all these kind of public bodies. And the signs, if you've looked at them, if you've ever seen them, are very, very vague. They're quite scarily vague. So it'll be things like, so the school ones I think are really interesting. So teachers are supposed to look out for these signs. A sudden change in behavior, a child who becomes more angry. These are obviously super vague and probably happen to all children at some point or another. But because we live in this wider context where we've been told again and again through the media and politicians treat Muslims with suspicion, everybody knows who they're looking for, really. It's like, you know, in the tube or train stations, it's now got the, see something, say something. And it's got this like kind of poster of this shadowy person. and then you'll hear on the tannoy, you know, if you see something suspicious, please report it, ring this number. It's interesting because I know that they're not asking me to report a certain type of person. They're asking me to report a different kind of person. And we all know who that person is and what that looks like. So that's the wider context I'm talking about, that we just know innately because we've been told again and again who to be suspicious about. And I raise that because that's led to these really absurd things. Like I think in 2015 to 2016, over 2,000 children were reported to PREVENT. So they had exhibited signs of radicalization. And of course we know that no child has ever committed an act of terrorist violence, right? So you now have this really interesting thing where there is this wide surveillance state, which is actually affecting the parameters of democracy, because even though we say that it's terrorists who are attacking our democracy, what's happening when you're actually limiting Muslims' freedoms of speech, for example, at university, so I was studying a few years ago, and there is this feeling, if you're a Muslim student, right, that if I voice a certain type of dissent, it might be seen that I'm radical, that might actually be what this is seen as. And if that is not a removal of or a limitation of people's freedom of speech, I don't know what is, but it's not seen as such, right? And so I wanted to highlight these contradictions and these hypocrisies, because ultimately what's happened with all this wider context I'm talking about is that the problem is seen as Muslims themselves. So you'll notice that actually, and it's called, I think, in like kind of in literature, people are talking about the securitization of Muslim identity. And what they mean is that now, to be deemed suspicious, you don't have to do anything in particular, you just have to seem Muslim. So your behavior, say you pray in a public place, that's actually cause for people to be scared and report you, right? So what's actually happened is that rather than crime being the criminal thing, what has become criminal is an identity. And that's because, like I say, we've placed violence as a thing that happens, as something that is innate in Muslims. And of course, this means that we don't hold anything else to account. So the government can say, gosh, we don't understand it. We should probably start, you know, in 2015, David Cameron said, we just need to teach Muslim women English. That'll help. And so you have these absurd and obviously kind of just pointless policies, really. They're not pointless because, you know, they actually perpetrate and perpetuate this racism, but pointless in the sense they're not tackling violence. And so I kind of have a short poem that I think kind of says this in a better way. But yeah, the ultimate point just being that we then don't talk about how foreign policy, how the politics of the state, how surveillance state, how harassing people through secret services, how the social and economic disadvantages that I've talked about, how the funding and arming of Britain overseas, how all these different things could be held accountable for violence may contribute to it. Instead, we just say something that they do, let's just make sure they're watched and kind of under surveillance. So this poem is called, so it's about that word that comes up, and it's, you'll have seen it in the newspaper, it's British-born, so it'll be British-born, and it's like, you know, this man, British-born Muslim man from Birmingham, let's say, commits act of violence. And I think that word is so interesting. I may as well just do the poem. So it's just a short one. Paper says British born. Like that's all it is, just an accident. They rubbed out British raised, desperately trying to deflect, erasing the context and connection, the fact this society made him, this land, this place, our words, our harm, but he's British born, not British. British, never British. They say the birthplace is somehow random, place his motives in a foreign land, must be the fact of his grandparents' blood, must be the fact of his skin. What a welcome from the heart of the empire, Raj of the Raj, a massive thumbs up from the hand which sliced us. British born, not British made, foreign goods somewhere deep inside. I'm British born, British passport, but neon hijab and signposted skin. Scanner goes off, obviously. A woman feels over me and looks straight through me. Random swabs are made, I am unmade. Passport says British, her eyes say British born only. I think that probably explained it, the point I was trying to make, that it's about this displacing, ignoring the context, essentially. So I've made all these points, and let me just check my notes, make sure I have made all the points. I made all these points, and I think the kind of conclusive thing that I want to say is that through all of this, so what I was saying is that, you know, ultimately we need to not just say, when something bad happens, we condemn this, we are not like this. That's not good enough. That's not gonna humanize us. That's not gonna give us our rights. That's not gonna actually protect us from what is happening in the world right now. Instead, I think we need to fundamentally question this whole context which allows for people to be dehumanized. And ultimately, that's what I see Islamophobia as. I don't see it as a phobia in the sense that it's just this interpersonal thing. It's this fear. I don't buy that. Islamophobia is a much more structural thing, as I've shown you. It's the way that policies work to look at Muslims as a suspect population. It's a way that the wider public has been influenced to think that anybody who behaves, exhibits, or looks like, which is also problematic, a Muslim, is deserving of suspicion, is potentially a criminal. And so it may seem in some ways that this is quite a cynical ending, but I'm gonna end on a final poem, which is hopefully a bit more uplifting. And I think from an Islamic point of view, I think there is a lot actually that we can do in this situation we're in. It can sound, so at the end of that poem that I did at the start, I kind of say, you know, is this radical? Am I radical? Because there is nowhere else left to exist now. But I think there is somewhere else left to exist. And I think that place as Muslims has always been there, because historically, at the time of the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, obviously there was so much persecution, so much kind of oppression, that I think we can see that the way that you're supposed to respond to that, the way that you should react, is to expose that injustice and to stand up for the truth. And so I think there are a lot of ways to do that. There's that hadith, which I will paraphrase, where, you know, if you see wrong occurring, injustice, oppression, the best thing that you can do is try to change it with your hand. And if you can't change it with your hand, you change it with your tongue. And if you can't change it with your tongue, you change it with your heart. And so I think that's a useful framework to use for us about what we can do. And I think you have amazing stories, for example, of someone like, I don't know if you guys heard the story of Mohammed Rabbani, who is an activist and a lawyer in the UK, and he was stopped at the border re-entering the UK, he's a British citizen, under something called Schedule 7, where you can kind of stop anybody without suspicion, and he was asked to unlock his phone at the border. He said, well, I can't unlock it because I have confidential information of a client on here. And they said, no, you've got to unlock it. He said, no, I can't, and so on and so forth, until they arrested him, they charged him, and he was convicted as under terrorism law for not unlocking his phone. Now, if that doesn't kind of expose the injustice of that law, I don't know what is. So to me, things like that, I mean, that's like very highly kind of aspirational, speaking out for truth, right? Standing up for justice, dissenting, even if it kind of sacrifices your own freedom to prove that something is wrong, something is unjust, and that is ultimately why he did it. So I'm gonna do a poem that is, actually I wrote it as a commission for a book, and I really recommend the book. The book is called A Virtue of Disobedience, and it's by Asim Qureshi, and he makes this argument that it is an Islamic duty for us to resist in the world that we're in right now. It is an Islamic duty, and it's amazing because he uses kind of stories of all the prophets to kind of show that, look, the situation we're in right now is one that requires truth speaking. I think just coming back to the reading at the start of this, I think something that I often think about is that actually in Islam, the concept of justice in a lot of ways foremostly comes to whether we serve justice to our own soul. So the idea that you oppress your soul, you can be unjust to your soul, and that is ultimately, to me, that's something that's really interesting, because if we don't stand up for justice in our own society, I believe that we are doing an injustice to our souls, right? And if we can kind of let go of the fears of the kind of, you know, worldly things, perhaps there is a way that we can continue to go forward. So I'll perform this poem. I hope my points have made sense tonight. And if you like my work, you can find me online at The Brown Hijabi. So I've monopolized the identity. I'll just go into this. So it's called A Virtue of Disobedience, after the book, like I say. We are the disobedient. Look upon us and despair. For we outlast history, time, and memory. We are always there. We are the unquenchable thirst for justice, the bodies that do not bend, tongues you cannot straitjacket, and eyes that will not be turned blind. We are the step you trip on in the night, the nightmare you wake from but cannot recall, the lump under the rolling hill that reminds you what is buried there. We are the disobedient. We bear witness and we testify. We love despite the lie that we are not worthy. We hold despite being told we should hide. Yes. We are the disobedient who refuse to die. For bodies without eulogies will never remain in their graves. We are the ghosts of the unmourned and the spirit of the never grieved. We are the original traitors to the tireless tyrant. We are Muhammad, we are Malcolm, we are Moses and Asata, we are Toussaint and Bashani, we are Rosa and Rabbani, we are the disobedient. Truth speakers with tongues of fire, knowledge seekers who provoke your ire, mouths always moist from sin, say a prayer, we are hearts beating for the truth. Not like fluttering birds in cages, but like the earth in her final convulsions, like mountains when they scatter to dust. We dismantle, uproot, expose, we are the disobedient. And we have come not to claim what is yours, but what is and always was ours, our humanity. But no, not claim, for it was always with us, and our announcement of that is the blasphemy you burn us for. But there's a reason you mustn't play with fire, because the flames are not bound by only your aims. If you burn our bodies in the morning, the fire will be licking your heels that night. Do you feel secure then, when we are bound not by law, but justice, loyal not to pen mark on paper, but truth? We are unconquerable and unmanageable, because you can take what you want if all you want is to take. We are your greatest fear, fearless, loyal not even to life. What bargain can be made then when disruption is our only security? In a world which says security is ensured only through our repression, what basis has such authority to be obeyed? No. We are the disobedient who refuse to know our place. Undivided, low and mighty, we are a we, a unity, a community, a principle above place. We are the disobedient. We declare the emperor naked and don't kneel before the queen. We smash the idols, confront the pharaoh, upend the fabric of the world. We will not sell our souls for hallowed halls. We cannot be unmoved. We are the disobedient. We overspill and overspeak. We are unboxed, unharnessed, unfathomable, unpalatable, uncompromising. Oh, Ozymandiases of the world, did you really think yourselves kings of kings? How quickly you forget. Nothing outlasts the fading of the day, but the light of truth itself. Jazakallah khair.
We have time for questions, if there are questions from the side.
Yeah, I think I actually used to watch a lot of slam poetry, like US slam poetry. So I think for me, I always was really intimidated by poetry, and I thought that was something that you only did at school in exams, and like I couldn't do that. But yeah, when I watched this other way of doing it, which was a lot more about speaking, about anger, about channeling frustration into a productive way, That is what I use. So less page poets than spoken word poets for me, actually. And obviously they're amazing, also hip hop artists like Akala, like Immortal Technique, because I think they say really, sometimes really important things in a really clever way that makes people listen. And like ultimately the poem that I did at the start, really, it was like, that was a condensed version of like the dissertation that I wrote, but obviously no one's gonna read that dissertation, it was so boring, but a lot of people can listen to the poem, it's accessible, so yeah.
Well, just one just one second, we've got a couple of questions and then come to you.
Thank you so much, I have to stand up because that was so moving. I'd like to listen to it again and again and like to go to sleep with that. So I wake up with the fire that you have. It's amazing. It's really. Can I ask you, when you said the brown hijabi, have you written on things like, you remember that on the WhatsApp about kill a Muslim and all that?
Yeah.
Right. Have you written about that?
I think so. I can't bring myself to write about all the Islamophobic things that happen because it's just like. But
can I then ask you? Maybe you might have written about the Palestinians being killed every Friday.
So I've been asked to write a lot about international politics, and I feel torn about it because on the one hand I of course feel very strongly about the plight of so many dispossessed people. I also worry about speaking over the experiences of people because there are a lot of brilliant Palestinian poets out there who can say it with so much more honesty and sincerity and truth than I can. So yeah, something I don't want to do is talk for other people because I think there's that famous quote that, you know, there is no there are no voiceless people, there are just those who are deliberately silenced. And so, yeah, not to go on about that point, but yeah, I just think people have asked me, you know, write about the Rohingya, write about the Syrians, write about refugees. And of course, these are all such important causes. And inshallah, I will find a way to write about it in a way that's not silencing. But for now, I worry.
I'd like to see you more on maybe mainstream television, holding talk shows, stuff like that, because you've got that drive. Thank you so much. That was a blessing.
Is it on now? Okay, cool. Thank you so much for that. It was so inspirational and so beautiful. My question is, you have this beautiful talent and you have this like source to reach people with your words and the injustice that you see, you've declared it with your talent. Some of us don't have this talent that you have, unfortunately. When you say that if you can't change it with your hands, then change it with your tongue, and if you can't change it with your tongue, change it with your heart. But for someone who doesn't have such like a following or people who, you know, listen to our words and, you know, are drawn to them, like what can we do?
No, I completely understand that question. So I think the reverse side of that question would be that I think everybody has a talent. It might not be that we all want to do spoken word poetry, but I do believe that in every walk of life and every, because Allah has placed us all here and gave us our own blessings, right? And it's not about comparing the blessings we're given, but using the ones we have. And so I think it can look whatever it looks like. It might be that you just speaking to the people in your life. To me, I think something that's very important is equipping people with a way to understand their reality, right? So sometimes I do that through poems, sometimes I do that through talking to people, but sometimes that can just look like a very intimate conversation between me and my mother. Sometimes that can look like a very complicated, frustrating conversation between me and my friends. But I think, I mean, I'm sure other people in this room have a lot of, actually the work that Miqdad does with, every day saying this is Islamophobic, this is Islamophobic, this is Islamophobic, I think questioning the media, whatever it is that you can do, wherever your talent lies, wherever your work is, I'm sure that there is something you can say, or there is something that you, that you can benefit somebody in some way. I do believe that. I'm not sure. Maybe other people have a better answer to that.
Population, 15%
of the prison population is Muslim.
But we as a Muslim are only 3% of the total population.
4.4%.
So what is the reason for that?
Okay.
There is a well-planned strategy on the part of the government to penalize the Muslim population.
So I think
generally we are very calm, family-oriented, educated. A lot of people go to the mosque regularly, even the young generation and children, and no other nationality, Hindu, Sikh, Jew, they go to their own religious centers.
So I think for me, we have to understand that
I think there's a well-planned strategy based on the prejudice, racialism on the part of the government to damage as much as possible to the Muslim community. Would you agree on that, or what is your comment on that?
I think in general, this country is structurally racist, and so there's been a lot of work to show that the justice system in particular, disadvantages people who are racial minorities. And I think there's a huge crossover between if you're poor, if you're a racial minority, and if you're Muslim. And these three things, I think, are very intertwined. So if you think about the things that might lead someone to be involved in activities that are labeled as criminal, which I also think is very questionable, the things that we call criminal and we don't, it's often people who are left with no other choice, people who are having to find a way to make money perhaps, or people who, on the other hand, like you say, if we want to talk about a kind of strategy, I do think the fact that you've created this population that are treated with suspicion, that are racially profiled, that are overly seen as criminal, does contribute, of course, because you've got this population. I think, you know, there is some evidence to show that you can just charge people and lock them away in a way to not have to look into more difficult charges. So those who are kind of picked up under surveillance, rather than kind of going down that route, looking into it, surveilling them further, you can just get them on drugs possession kind of charge, things like that. So yeah, I think structural racism, I think we can all agree, hopefully we can all agree, exists in the criminal justice system. But I think we need to think to treat it as a structural rather than conspiracy problem, because I think it is a real thing. And we don't, like I say, I don't actually believe that we have to say we're well-educated, we have good families, we go to the masjid. I don't think we have, you know, we don't, that's not a reason to not be in prison, right? We, even if we didn't do any of those things, we shouldn't be 15% of the population in prison. Inshallah, if we all leave here today and do something, that will help. Yeah.
Thank you very much. It was really inspiring. I guess my question is, has there been, I'm not sure what the right word is, but maybe state resistance to kind of you speaking out? Or are you seen as kind of still a good type of Muslim, if you see what I mean?
Yeah,
have they
started
to categorize you in a particular
way?
No,
absolutely. I think I definitely have the advantage of I'm on this line of I know how to manage my palatability, right? I think the fact that I am a woman already kind of gives me advantage of, oh, well, women can't be terrorists. You know, like, they're all oppressed, so that helps. So that definitely helps make me palatable, yeah. But I think it definitely frustrates people that I don't say the right line. And I've been in interviews and stuff where they'll be like, so, you know, why is it that you cover your hair? And I'll be like, why is it that you ask all Muslim women that question? And, you know, and so I think, there is this perception that, well, I'm not in that bad, radical, conservative Muslim camp. And yet I'm not exactly, so yeah, but I'm aware of that. I kind of feel like I'm playing that, and it's, at the moment, I'm able to reach a kind of broad section of society because I'm not yet seen as an extremist yet.
Sorry, can I ask a follow-up question? Yeah. Do you think it's partly to do with the way that you express anger? So there is a kind of polite way of expressing anger, and then there's an angry way of expressing anger.
Yeah.
And I think our societies tend to be much more accepting, I mm-hmm. guess, of this kind of more sophisticated
Absolutely.
Anger, so to speak.
Yeah.
And is that a strategy we need to adopt, do you think? Or is there some benefit and kind of power in raw anger?
Okay, so that's kind of like two questions. I think that's really interesting. I definitely think that I think it's really interesting, this label artist. And I found it really, I've grappled recently with people being like, oh, you're an artist, you're a creative. I'm like, am I, or just am I angry Muslim? Like, what, I'm not sure. So yeah, that's really interesting. And I do think it's a way to depoliticize, in a sense, some of the stuff that I'm saying. But on the other hand, art is also this place where people are allowed to be very political, and in other arenas you're not really allowed to be. But in terms of what you're saying, like, how do I think people should express their anger? I don't know, I'm kind of thinking this aloud as you're asking, and I think it's a really good question, and like one for, I guess, everyone to think about in their own lives. I think for me, like, when you talk about raw anger, I'm trying to imagine what that would look like for me, and I think sometimes I feel undermined by my own raw anger. So for example, if you were to tackle me one-on-one in a conversation, and I was to get very angry and be like, no, you're completely misunderstanding this, we're dehumanized, like, why aren't you understanding that? I sometimes feel that I would actually end up undermining myself just because I'm not as articulate when I'm in that raw stage of anger. I'm not whatever. And so for me, this works because it's like I've had time to think. I like to write down my ideas before I speak them, etc. But there are absolutely other people who are brilliant in that raw anger state. I don't know if you guys saw Question Time last night with Akala on it, but like I think he sometimes embodies that way because he's so articulate and eloquent. He can just, you can see he's so fired up and he's doing that. Obviously, there's anger that's not just spoken, and there's anger that is in actions. On the way here, I was reading really interesting. This is from 1981, so I said from Leeds. There was like this case of these 12 Asian youths who were arrested, and they're called the Bradford 12. What they had done is that they'd made a huge box of Molotov cocktails, and they'd done it because there's going to be a National Front march in Bradford, and so the argument was self-defense because the police were completely negligent about the racial harassment people were facing, and so they'd created these weapons in self-defense. I think that argument makes sense to me. Like, if you're not being protected by the system that's supposed to protect you, what else would you do? But I guess I'm just talking around because I'm not really sure. I think for me this works, but Yeah, I think there are many ways to express anger. Sometimes they're visual, sometimes they're... Yeah, and I think violence can look like lots of different things as well. But antagonism, yeah, and I kind of am talking about more widely antagonism, like what, you know, some people perhaps do express the fact that they're antagonized in ways that the state says, this is not okay, you are now a terrorist because you've done it in this way. Whereas the state has also created the language of the war on terror, which is this borderless, boundaryless war. But when certain individuals adopt that same language to say, well, therefore, we will kill on this soil, which is borderless, boundless, under your state, then that's seen as not okay, even though it's adopting the same language of the war on terror. So anyway, yeah, I'm just rambling a bit, but yeah, I think that's a really good question for everyone to think about, maybe.
Sorry, I haven't read a lot of your work so far, but I will. Have you written or thought about this very peculiar British phenomenon when something goes wrong, we have an inquiry, and we say everything was wrong, everything was bad, appalling, whatever, whatever, but nobody has done anything wrong.
Wait, can you give an example?
So, there recently you see this case of this Libyan
couple, yeah?
Appalling everything, but nobody has done anything wrong.
Right, yeah.
And so in that, they sort of cover up.
Yeah.
They sort of say, yes, sorry, we are very
There's
sorry.
No accountability, no culpability.
No accountability, nothing to be changed. Mm. Well, if you look at the Levinson inquiry, even to this day, those guys are saying that the police cannot be institutionally racist. Or this culture of... hostile environment for immigration and Windrush. Again, nobody has done wrong, but everything is being wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So I think this is one way in which this, since you're a student of post-colonialism, the empire covers its tracks
absolutely
without pinpointing who it was. I think maybe worth writing a poem on this, this question there.
No, absolutely. And I think that reminds me, recently I was watching the Stephen Lawrence documentary that came out recently. And at the end, I was just thinking, you know, this idea that I think Theresa May said there's going to be a Stephen Lawrence Memorial Day now, like that's that. It's like, wow, is that that's what we get after all that? He gets a day. That's it's just like, wow, is that? It's just yeah, I agree. There's no accountability really. There's no questioning of the fundamental issues at hand.
Basically, I'm a student of banking, so you know the whole banking system went belly up, and we found a lot of issues, but not a single banker has been jailed. So nobody has done anything wrong.
Mm.
Okay, I think it's okay, we'll end there. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.